Good morning, church. We serve a great, mighty God. He's so good. Let's stand. Let's worship him this morning.
Good as your mercy endure it forever. For you are good as your mercy endure it forever. People from every nation come, from generation to generation, we worship you.
How are you guys doing? Good, good. I get the privilege today to baptize three men, and I don't get to do this a lot because you guys got me busy doing other stuff. And today I'm thankful to be able to do this. I always want to make it very clear, there's nothing magical or mystical about this water up here. It is warm. And normally we thank God for that. Today I'm like, you know, I could probably handle cold. That would have been good. But anyway, this water is just merely a symbol. Just like I wear a wedding band that's a symbol to everyone that I'm married. the wedding band's not marriage. Well, this water is a symbol of the cleansing and the washing of sin that happens when someone puts their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And can I tell you, I'm thankful. Here's what it represents. Every sin that I've ever committed before I came to Christ and every sin I will ever commit has been cleansed and forgiven. That means that now there's nothing that separates me from God because of Jesus Christ. And so if you're here today and you've never followed through in believer's baptism, it's the first act of obedience of being a follower of Christ, I'm not even going to say pray about it, think about it, talk to somebody about it. I'm just going to ask you this. Why not? Why? Why would you delay? No, man. Be quick. Hey, I've given my life to Jesus. I'm unashamed, and I want the world to know. And so today we celebrate with these men. They made this decision at our men's conference this weekend to follow through in believer's baptism. I'll share their story a little bit with you as they come. But if you're here today and you're like, you know what? Because of their example, I need to be obedient because of what God's word says. Then come and talk to us. Let's get something set up for you, okay? All right. Come on down, buddy. Turn around right here, Austin. So this is Austin. And was it Friday night, Austin? Friday night, he gave his life to Jesus Christ in our men's conference and came out and spoke to us. And I tell you what I love about Austin. He's like, well, there's no need to delay. Let's go ahead and get this thing moving. And so today he stands before you knowing that he belongs to Jesus. And so today, Austin, it is my honor to be able to baptize you, but it's also my responsibility to publicly ask you this question. Who is the Lord of your life?
Jesus Christ.
Amen. Based upon that public profession, yeah, go ahead, man. He said, Pastor, my whole family's come today, and even a few friends have come to witness this. Austin, based upon that public profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I can baptize you today as my brother in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Congratulations, buddy. So this is JR, and JR came to know Christ Saturday morning. And again, went and said, you know what, I want to go ahead and follow through and let's just get this thing on the road. And then he was telling me, he said, last night and this morning, the old devil was working on me saying, oh, you can put this off. You don't need to do this. He said, but no, I want to honor and be obedient to my Lord. So, JR, today it is my honor to be able to baptize you. It's also my responsibility to publicly ask you, who is the Lord of your life?
Jesus.
Amen. JR, based upon that public profession of faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I can baptize you today as my brother in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Congratulations, buddy. I think Ryan lined them up where we go taller and taller. This is my friend Brent. Brent and his wife started attending church here, I don't know, about a year and a half ago when they came to watch his daughter get baptized. And they've just kind of hung around and began growing in their faith. And Brent said, I've trusted Jesus as my Savior a while back, but I've never been obedient in baptism. And so this weekend, as he was studying in our conference about the man that God's created us to be and how God wants us to be a leader, he went out and said, this is an area of my life that I need to get right. And so today, that's what he is doing before you. So Brent, today it is my honor to be able to baptize you but it is also my responsibility to ask you publicly, who is the Lord of your life?
Jesus Christ.
Amen. Brent, based upon that public profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I can baptize you today as my brother in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
I almost got away, I didn't.
Yeah, old Brent almost baptized me, I tell you what. Great way to start this service. In the old days, that water would have come right over the top of my waders, and I'd been wet all morning long. I'm thankful for swim trunks. Hey, if you're visiting with us today, thank you for coming. Thank you for being here. You are our honored guest. We'd love to tell you about our church, answer any questions that you may have, kind of tell you the reason why we exist. Do us a favor, if you fill out one of our guest registration cards, there's some physical cards that are in chair back pockets around the room. You just pull it out and fill it out. Or if you want to, you can do it electronically. At the end of the service, you'll see a slide that's going to come up on the screens. And in that slide, it's going to have a lot of different decisions that you can make, and you can text a word. It'll be self-explanatory, but you can text whatever word's there that would correspond to your decision to the phone number on the screen. Well, if you're a guest today, and that's how you're doing your guest card, you just simply text the word guest to the phone number that's on the screen. If you've never stopped by our Welcome Center, may I encourage you to do that today. And if you brought a guest with you, bring them out there. We'll go ahead and put in their hand information about our church, answer any questions they may have face-to-face, as well as there'll be folks out there that would be happy to speak with you, pray with you, and help you in any way they can. You know, this past weekend was a great time here at Highland Park. Friday night kicked off our men's conference. And ladies, I witnessed something that I know that you already knew. Them boys can eat. They cooked over 600 steaks, and I think they ate just about every one of them. And thank the Lord, he's so gracious, those were some fat steaks. So we're thankful for that. We had a great time, and this weekend we had 30 men who publicly indicated that they gave their life to Jesus Christ. And so our staff and the team that helps them, they're working on follow-up, and you were able to see this morning just some fruit of that weekend. And so we are thankful, thankful, thankful for the God that we serve. Today, I preached a little bit this weekend at the men's conference. Dr. Hunt, he preached a little bit as well. And I said, you know, you're in town. I want you to stay, and I want you to preach on Sunday morning. He travels all over. He was just this past week in South Carolina, and then I think he was in North Carolina the Sunday before that, and Georgia. And I think he's, I know he was in Uganda for a little while. And, I mean, my lands, I can't keep up with the guy. But I said, while you're home, at your home church, come and preach. So I'm excited for the word. God moved in our first service. Hearts were stirred, altars were full, and we believe that he's going to honor the preaching of his word in this service as well. So after we sing in just a moment, I've told Dr. Hunt just to come on up and clear off a space and have a spell right on the stage, and we'll be blessed by that. I do want to ask our ushers to go ahead and come forward this morning as we take our tithe and our offering, just an act of worship, just as we sing praise and glory unto Jesus. When we give, it is an act of worship and praise. It is an act of faith. And it's a neat thing that God takes what we give individually and corporately. He puts it all together. And as a result, he will use it so that the gospel will go far and wide through the ministry of this church. You've heard me say, I don't know that we will really know this side of glory, the impact this church has had around the world. In our first service today, we had a pastor who had preached here for a few years in the 90s. He visits us from time to time. A friend of mine, Brother Skip Parvin, was here in the first service. And I love Brother Skip, and he is so encouraging. He says all the time, every time he shows up, first of all, it was a little humorous because he came in this morning, he had shorts on, and he said, oh, Brother Stephen, I didn't bring any long pants to the beach. I hope I'm okay. And I'm like, no, Brother Skip, I'm going to use that as an excuse to tell the church, Brother Skip said, I can start preaching in shorts. So anyway, Maybe not, but he was here, and he's so kind. And I want you to listen to this. This is a testimony of the goodness of God and your faithfulness. He says, every time I come and walk around this place, it doesn't even seem like the same place I pastored in the 90s. Because it's not. And I'm not saying she's better. I'm just saying Jesus decided to showcase this church around the world. And we are the ones that get to be beneficiaries of that. Here's what I mean by that. He's working through us, and it doesn't have a flat thing to do with who you and I are. It has everything to do with who he is. And we're just getting to go along with the ride, right? And so we're thankful for that, and what a great word of encouragement that was from Pastor Skip. But today, just be reminded as we take this tithe and offering, God's going to use your gift of obedience beyond anything we'll be able to see with physical eyes here. And you're a giving church. You really are a giving church. Let us continue to be faithful in this. Today you can give by putting something physical in the bucket as it comes by, or you can give, text to give. You'll see it on the screen. It's safe. It's convenient. The way you give, not as important as the obedience in the act of giving, okay? Let me lead us in a word of prayer, and then after I pray, the ushers will come around, and we'll come up. We'll start singing again. After a few songs, Dr. Hunt will jump up there and let loose, okay? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for what we've already witnessed today. Thank you for the three that were baptized in the first service. Thank you for these three men baptized in this service. God, thank you that you allow us as a church to be able to see these beautiful baptismal waters stirred, because we know what they represent, a changed life, a life that'll never be the same, Jesus, a life whose sins have been forgiven and the shackles have been removed. And Jesus, I can't help but believe there might be someone in this room, someone watching online or even by television today. They're still shackled to their own sin. And so, Lord, I pray that today you would bring conviction to their heart, that your Holy Spirit would help them to realize that they're lost and they need to be saved. That today, Jesus, they call upon your name, and that you would do the greatest miracle that could ever occur. You would redeem them and set them free. Lord, our prayer is that you would send your Holy Spirit to guide us in our service. God, you're so good to us. Bless all the things that are happening through the name of Highland Park today. More importantly, Jesus, you bless all that's happening through the name of Jesus today. We love you, and we thank you for loving us. We pray this today in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. As our ushers start coming around, let me go ahead and remind you and encourage you. We've got a great children's and preschool ministry. Some grandmamas that would love to love on your kids and teach them about God's word in a more appropriate setting. And so if you'd like to take advantage of that today, all you have to do is walk right out the vomitorium, and there'll be folks out there that could point you to the direction of our children's ministry. Corey, let's sing.
From the darkness, I called your name. Into darkness, your mercy came. You called me out, lifting me up. How great is your love? You bore my weakness, you took my shame, bearing my burdens in fields of grace. You called me out, lifting me up. How great is your love? From the heights of heaven, you stepped down to earth, in a sin perfection. acquainted with our grief, man of sorrow, son of suffering. Oh, blood and tears, how can it be? There's a God who weeps, there's a God who bleeds. Oh, praise the one who would reach for. Down in merciful pursuit to the sinner, you were grace, and the broken you were grace. In the end, the proof is in your words. In the end, the proof is in your words. Oh, blood and tears. The Son of Sons.
you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we just praise you this morning, Lord. All the glory to you. Everything that we do is for you, Lord. We want to give it to you. And just thank you, Lord, that you're in this place, Lord. Lord, that you fill us with your Spirit. And Lord, that you constantly come after us. Lord, I pray right now as Brother Johnny comes and brings your word, Lord, open our hearts and our minds to what you have for us. Lord, we'll just give you all the praise in the precious, powerful, mighty, amazing name of Jesus we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, the music was just, as it always is, incredible. How blessed. What a joy it is for Janet and me and our family to be members here. I was thinking earlier that I've really only been a member of two churches that I was not pastor of. So I was saved at Longleaf Baptist Church in Wilmington, North Carolina, went off to Garden Web University and pastored Livonia Baptist Church, left there, went to Wake Forest, North Carolina, the Southeastern Seminary, and pastored the Falls Baptist Church, and then I had the opportunity to go back and pastor the church I was converted in, Longleaf, and then I served 33 years at First Baptist Church, Woodstock. So that actually means this is the only church I've ever been a member of that I've not been the pastor of. And the pastor informed me in the early service that there is not a vacancy here. So we love it here. We not only love our church family, Janet and I joined last summer, but we also love the staff. We've become very good friends with so many of them, and they've been so kind, encouraging, and accommodating. And then I certainly love my pastor, and I'm grateful for his strong exposition of God's word week by week. And so it's just been a real joy to be here. If you have a copy of God's word or you want to pull it up in the phone or whatever, Acts 24, and it also will be on the screens. And I'm going to focus just on two verses of scripture, verse number 24 of Acts 24, and also verse 25. And so I want you to listen carefully. I want to speak on this subject, missed opportunities. I believe in the Bible, the passage that I read, that there's really like bold print that says all over this story, missed opportunities. Did you know sometimes you miss an opportunity and it is impossible for it to come around again? Now, the missed opportunity I'm going to talk about today, I really do pray with the compassion of my heart and the compassion of Christ that it won't be the last opportunity, but there's no promise that it won't be the last opportunity. So I'm reading from Acts 24, beginning at verse 24. The Bible says, after some days when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was Jewish, he sent for Paul and heard him, and listen what he heard, concerning the faith in Christ. Now, Paul reasoned, as he reasoned about righteousness, three things, righteousness, self-control, and the judgment to come. Felix was afraid and answered, go away from now. When I have a convenient time, I will call for you. When I was pastoring Longleaf Baptist Church in Wilmington, one of the unique privileges I was afforded since I was going back home to serve there is my mother was a member. So my mom would tell me every Sunday where she'd meet me, and I would always see her. But she called me early one Sunday morning and she said, son, I'm not feeling well. My mom was only 60 years old. She had battled a lot of health issues. So that afternoon after lunch, I went over to New Hanover Hospital and made some visits. I'll never forget this. I pulled out of the hospital. If I would take a right, I could be at my mom's house in 5 minutes. If I take a left, I'd go to Longleaf Baptist Church, and I had a deacon's meeting, but I was not in a hurry. But I made a decision. I'm going to go on and get ready for the deacons, and I'll check on my mother tomorrow. My mom passed away that night. What a missed opportunity. And let me just say to you, as candidly as I can, I'll never have that opportunity again. So I've often thought I would have loved to have seen her that night. Now, I'm going to talk about my missed opportunities right now instead of yours, so you ought to thank God for that. But one missed opportunity is 85% of the people that will gather across the United States today in a gospel-preaching church. They're there because somebody invited them or brought them. So, Olivia, I bet your parents brought you. But they invited us. So a man by the name of N.W. Pridgen, I'm a Lumbee Indian, Native American, he was also, he invited me to church. My wife had been asking me to go. I was 20 years old. I'd never owned a Bible. I was a high school dropout, had managed a pool hall, was a hustler, and sort of a community hoodlum. But I decided I wanted to go to church. And after a few weeks, guess what happened? I heard the gospel. God clearly spoke to my heart. I couldn't explain it then. The Bible says that he convicted me, which means he exposed my need. And by the way, no pressure on me this morning, because nobody can do that but Jesus. So he began to woo me, draw me to himself. And so I was soundly converted to Jesus Christ at the age of 20. I was really being dealt with in a morning service, but I was just shy. Believe it or not, the reason I quit school the day I did, I was supposed to give a public book report, and I didn't like speaking publicly. God has a sense of humor, doesn't he? I've been reporting ever since. Years passed. We left Longleaf, moved to the Atlanta area to Woodstock, where we would call home till just last year, for the last 36 years. My phone rang one day, and it was Edna Pridgen, and here's what she said. She said, N.W. went to be with the Lord yesterday. You know how he loved you and how he loved to hear you tell the story of how you invited him to church. So, of course, we want you to do his funeral. I'm ashamed of what I'm getting ready to tell you. I said, I think I can do it. Then he said, well, we want you to know you're going to be sharing the platform. And they named another preacher that had been as mean to me as anybody I knew. He had told lies on me. My wife, tell you, I confronted him. He continued to be so persuasive in telling his stories. You know what I did? I called her and told her my schedule was full, but the church I was serving then, I'd not be able to do it. I know what you're thinking right now. Boy, I'm surprised they let you preach today. But I want you to know, time passed, and guess what happened? The same Holy Spirit that convicted me of my sin to be saved convicted me that I'd lied. And so I called Mrs. Pridgen, and I begged her forgiveness. And I really believe she forgave me. But I want to tell you something. That was a missed opportunity. I wish to God, look at me. I wish to God I had that opportunity to do over again. Hey, can I ask a very candid question? I wonder if there's anybody out in eternity and they're separated from God, and what they would give for that missed opportunity, for one more opportunity. In the Bible, he's a governor. His name is Felix. He's a Roman governor. He's in Jewish-occupied land, dominated by the Romans. And so I thought about it, and I wrote three major statements about him. So let me talk to you about him. Number one, let me talk to you about the chance-giving Felix. Now, I think this is a good question. What is the chance of somebody from Rome ending up in Israel in the Middle East, going to a town by the name, one of my favorites, Caesarea by the Sea. And in that town, a man be arrested for preaching the gospel that wrote over half of the New Testament, that today historians and theologians would say of Paul that he was the greatest Christian statesman that ever lived apart from Jesus Christ. What is the chance that Felix would get to meet with him? By the way, do we have any reason to understand why he would want to meet with him? We do. He's married to a Jewish lady. He's a Gentile. You do understand, if you're not a Jew, you're a Gentile. I'm a Native American. This land that you're living on, this is my land. But I'm a Gentile, and you're a Gentile, unless you're a Jew. He married a lady named Drusilla. We believe it was her curiosity that led them to ask, can we meet with the Apostle Paul? They knew who he was. What can you tell me about Drusilla? Oh, you should know her. You've read about her daddy. Her daddy was King Herod, number one. He killed the babies after the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember, find all the children under two, execute them. We've got to eliminate a potential king or Messiah. A lot of people have tried to kill him. He's also one that through the Apostle Peter that would preach the great Pentecost sermon where 3,000 would be saved. They threw him in prison intending to kill him after Easter. But God sovereignly, supernaturally released him from prison. But guess what he did? He killed one of my friends. He killed James, the brother of John. If you've studied the Bible, you fall in love with the characters. I love the Zebedee boys. They had some spunk about them. They're the ones when Jesus preached to the Samaritans and they wouldn't get saved, he said, let's call down fire from heaven. And Jesus said, no, we won't do that. Why? Because Jesus is so compassionate and so long-suffering. I don't know how old you are, but if you got much age on you, you're not a Christian. Let me tell you why you're still here. The long-suffering of Almighty God, the forbearance of the Heavenly Father, His own long-stretched arm of grace is waiting on you to come to Him. Wait a minute. Do we know anything else about Drusilla? We not just only know Agrippa 1. That's the daddy. How about her brother? Yeah, her brother is the one that the Apostle Paul will stand about up in front of, and I'm going to give you one of the most powerful verses of missed opportunities from Acts 26:28, and I'll close my sermon talking about King Agrippa, and that's who Paul would stand in front of. And so here's a guy that's got a chance, traveled a long distance, probably by boat, from Rome, and he gets a chance to stand before one of the greatest Christians that would ever live. Now, this couple's, their characters, listen to what history, anybody that wants to read history can find this. Drusilla was Felix's third wife. He first had been married to the granddaughter of Antony and Cleopatra. While in her teens, Drusilla had been given in marriage to the king of Syria. But then Felix saw her, fell in love with her. This is unbelievable. Hired a magician and lured her away from her husband. What a dude. And by the way, in just a moment, God is going to use the Apostle Paul, please hear these words, to zero in on all of our greatest dilemma. And so what a chance. What a chance. But let me go to a second statement. Let me talk for a moment about the charge given to Felix. This is interesting. Sometimes, I don't know why, but through the years, Pastor, I probably preach more sermons with 3 points. People would even come to me sometimes, they say, why do you always preach 3? And I had a normal response. Aren't you grateful to God it's not 10? Yeah. But the Bible says they heard him concerning faith. Hey, stay with me. It is one thing for me to preach the gospel. It is another thing to hear it from the one that the Holy Spirit inspired to write it. And so he's going to talk about 3 things. I'm going to put it in a category. He's going to talk to him first and foremost of his present need. I want to personalize this, and I want to make it present tense. If you'll listen, I'm going to talk about the most present need in the heart of every person that can hear my voice. Any that are watching online, any that will download this sermon in the future, if you ever hear this message, I am doing my absolute best to talk to you about your greatest need. Some of you have got some things you want to do, but listen to me carefully. You have no greater need than what I'm going to address this morning. The Bible says he reasoned about righteousness. If you're not careful, we judge one another. We'll say something like this. Well, if he's going to heaven, I'm going to heaven. Well, I think I'm as good a person as he is. Let me settle something. I am not going to heaven because I'm better than anybody else. I'm going to heaven because one day I realized I didn't have what I needed to go to heaven. I needed the righteousness of God. And the only way I could receive that is through receiving Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and that I had to confess that I was a sinner. I could not do what the first parents in the Bible did. What I'm preaching goes all the way back to the book of Genesis. When Adam and Eve sinned against God, they knew they were sinners, and they felt naked before God. So what they did is got some fig leaves, and they sewed them together. But they realized that was not sufficient. So the Bible teaches God threw them out of the garden. But God was not done with them, because God, are y'all listening, is a very compassionate God. I'm telling you, God loves you like you are, but the good news is God loves you too much to leave you like you are. So what he did, oh, this is beautiful. Almighty God killed an innocent animal. Why would he do that? Because he wanted to give you a picture of Good Friday. He wanted to show you what happened on Easter weekend. He wanted you to know that on Friday, he who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Jesus Christ. And so what he did, he killed an innocent animal, and that's what had to die. An innocent person had to die. And Jesus Christ knew no sin, but he was willing to bear our sins so we could have his righteousness. And by the way, the greatest transaction in the Bible is the only thing I could give God is my sinfulness. And God said, if you'll give that to me, I will give you my prime prize, my righteousness. Wow. And so he talked to him about righteousness in Christ. So when an innocent animal was slain in Genesis, it was a picture of the cross, that God would allow his innocent, harmless, sinless, holy son die in my place. So he began to talk to them about their present need. Did you know Jesus told parables? Here's what has been said about parables. Parables are heavenly stories with earthly meanings. Listen to one. Jesus said, I want to tell you a story about a king who threw a banquet. And he informed the people that nobody could come into the banquet unless they had on a robe. So it was known you couldn't go into that banquet without a robe. Now, listen to me carefully. The Bible teaches that nobody can go into heaven without Jesus. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to my Father but by me. Jesus Christ is not a good way. He's not even the best way to God. He's the only way to God. And so he lays that out in the scripture in showing their present need, that there's nothing greater of a need than Jesus Christ. And so he presents that to them. So in this parable, a guy goes in without a robe. Now, he must have thought, well, if they come and ask me where my robe is, I'm going to have a good answer. So, for instance, some of you may think, if I know you teach that we can't go to heaven without Jesus, but I believe one day if I stand before God and he hears my story, how really my good outweighed my bad, and I can tell him some of the great things, I think he's probably going to let me in. So you've got it all figured out, what you're going to say. And by the way, you do need to come up with what you plan to say if you think you're going to get there anyway other than Jesus. Well, the Bible says that finally the king came in, walked over to the guy without a robe and said, "Sir, how came you in without a robe?" And I want you to hear this honestly. It is overwhelming. The man looked, and the Bible says he was speechless. See, now you think, oh, I've got it all worked out. I know what I'll say. But when you stand before him, you're speechless. We only do it for witnessing purposes, but we ask the question every now and then. Listen to this. James Kennedy is famous for it. He's been with the Lord for some time, a great Presbyterian from Fort Lauderdale. He would ask this question. Suppose you were standing before God right now, and he would ask you, "Why shall I let you into my heaven?" What do you think you would say? And then we come up with all kinds of answers. Well, I've been good. I've been baptized. I'm a Baptist. But the Bible says in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 2 that we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. What does that mean? Jesus Christ is our acting attorney. Did you know that you can go to court today, and if you've got a good attorney, most likely you will never be on the stand, you'll never say a word? I was preaching this one day at Woodstock, and we had one of the great songwriters in the United States, really in the world for Christian music, Eddie Carswell, with a new song. They have the largest music tour in the whole world. And he was sitting there, and I preached that, and he wrote a song, and it became number one contemporary music song of that year. And it was entitled, you can Google it, "This One's With Me." And here's what I said. What does it mean for Jesus Christ to be your advocate? Well, if I were to stand before the Father, and the Father were to say, "Johnny, why shall I let you into my heaven?" I would not say a word because I'm speechless in the presence of Almighty God. That's why we sing that song, and it's so popular, young people. I can only imagine. Will I say anything? Will I fall before him? We don't know, but we know that we can't plead our own case. But I believe at that moment when he asked that Jesus Christ will step out of the shadows and say, "Father, this one's with me. That's why I died on Calvary. And he will be my advocate, my lawyer, the Lord Jesus Christ." So I'm not getting there because of me. I'm not going because I've been good. I'm not going because I'm a preacher. I'm going because Jesus Christ paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. That's the difference. And then quickly he reasoned about self-control. Now remember, this couple is out of control. But here's what he's saying. Listen to this. Here's what he's saying to Drusilla and to Felix. "You let me clothe you in my righteousness, and part of that is I give you my disposition." The very nature of God, Jeremy Camp sings it perfectly when he says, the same Christ, the same God that raised Jesus from the dead lives in me. And so you have now Christ living in you. The Holy Spirit of God is living in you. And so now all I need to do each day is yield my life to him. He lives his life through me. Wow, so he's saying to them, hey, your life's been out of control. You're a worldly wise man. You're used to getting your own way at any cost by a ruthless exercise of power. Here's a young girl following her passions and the sinful unions with her lovers. but the Spirit-filled life will give you self-control. If I could quote them right now, but in Galatians chapter 5 and verse 23, of the fruit of the Spirit, the Bible lists 9 words, and the last word is self-control. And then he talks to them about judgment to come. This is interesting. I love to do research. You know what research shows from the what's called Pew Research? In other words, like asking people in the church of all denominations across the world what theology they like, what doctrines they like. You know, like it's a smorgasbord. I like it when the preacher preaches about grace and love of God in heaven, but I sure wish he'd leave that hell stuff alone, or wouldn't talk about lostness or separation from God. It's not smorgasbord. The Bible commended the Apostle Paul that he had preached the whole counsel of God to him. So it's not smorgasbord. It's like you can't leave off your vegetables. You got to leave all of it. And so he says judgment to come. Let me show you how level the ground is in here. We must all appear before the judgment of God. Not the same place, though. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, I'm going to the judgment seat of Christ. It's called the Bema. Everybody there will be saved. Some will be saved as by fire. What does that mean? It means there's some things that you got credit for that God didn't give you credit for, because he knows it weren't motivated by the love of God, it weren't empowered by the Spirit of God, and it weren't done only for the glory of God. And so the Bible says the eyes of Jesus will look at us in that day, and that it'll be combustible, and that some of the things we've done have been categorized as wood, hay, and stubble, and it'll be burned up. But then he said other things that you've done will be silver and gold and precious stone. And he said this will just be purified. And then God will reward you for it. And said, here's what he said. Some of you will be saved, but as by fire. But let me say something real good. Thanks be unto God, we're still saved. That's Christians. How about if you've never trusted Christ? This is Jesus' teaching, okay? Look at it. I'm giving you the verses. Revelations chapter 20, verse 6. What's it called? The Great White Throne Judgment. Who's going to be there? The small and the great. What does that mean? It doesn't matter how low in life you were or how high you were. It doesn't matter what, if you were a dignitary, a president, if you were a prime minister. It doesn't matter. Small or great will appear before the great white throne judgment. The Bible says that God will open the books. And he's going to allow us to do what we've always said we wanted to do. You read it. He said he's going to open the books of works. Why? Because he's made record of that. He knows you're going to try to use it. Lord, wait a minute. I don't deserve to go to hell. Look what I did. But here's what he's going to remind you. I told you over and over again that you don't go to heaven because of your works. You go to heaven because of my work. And my work was I placed my son on the cross. I allowed him to pay a debt he did not owe, because all of us owed a debt we could not pay. And I'm going to make a statement. I want you to read it in your Bible, because it's the teaching of the Lord Jesus Christ. Sometimes when people haven't studied their Bible well, they think a preacher is saying harsh things, when the truth is, somebody should have, on my way here today, I thought, gosh, if I say what the Bible says, sometimes people think that you're harsh or whatever. Let me tell you something. If I don't tell you what the Bible says, it's like giving you medicine in a bottle where I've changed the labels, and it could do you much harm. That would be wrong. He says that everyone at the great white throne judgment goes to hell. Everybody there, here's what it says, is turned into the lake of fire. Read it. Really young. And I'll tell you one thing. When I stand before God, there won't be anybody standing there saying, I want to take an issue with Johnny Hunt. He wouldn't tell the truth. Judgment to come. That's the prospect. But let me wrap it up by talking about the callousness of him. Oh, by the way, this is extremely interesting. After Felix heard this message, guess what the Bible says? The Bible says that he trembled. Oh, I'm going to sit down on this. I need to sit down. You mean the preacher scared him? Are y'all listening to me? I'm trying to preach what the Bible says.
I went to hear that man. I'm not going back to hear that man. He scared me. If you're not a Christian, you have every reason to be afraid.
Oh, by the way, can I translate the Greek word for trembled? It means the hair on the back of his neck stood up. And it was affecting him. But listen what he said. Go away for now. And when I have a more convenient season, I'll call you. He was not in charge. Over there, it was King Agrippa was in charge, and I close with his. When Paul preached the same message to him, guess how he responded? Listen to the words. Almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. And you know what song was written? Almost persuaded, now to believe. Go, Spirit, go thy way. Come back a more convenient day. He was 15 years old. He was in a revival service. It was a big revival. He went two nights in a row. His best friend invited him. After two nights, he told his best friend, I'm not going back. He said, why? He said, preacher pointed at me. He said, I know he's talking about me. There were thousands there, thousands. I know he's talking about me. His friend insisted, please, let's go back. And so he came up with a scheme. If you'll go back with me tomorrow night, we'll join the choir and we'll be sitting behind the preacher. So they joined the choir so the preacher wouldn't point at them. It was November the 1st, 1934. Guess what? The boy said later, the 15-year-old boy, by the way, he was going to turn 16 November the 7th. He said, even though I'm sitting behind him, I still could feel his finger pointing at me. See, some of you may think that I'm making you uncomfortable. I want to say something to you. It's God the Holy Spirit. It is God the Holy Spirit. He honors the gospel. That's how God woos you, convicts you, exposes your need, so he can draw you to him, so he can become your Lord and Savior. You were created to know God. You were made by God for himself. That night, that 15-year-old boy said they sang all five stanzas of Just As I Am. So, you ever been in a service, you think, good Lord, they sang that song 100 times. 5 times they sang it. And this boy didn't respond, so guess what they did? They flipped over and said, we're going to sing another invitation hymn. They sang Almost Persuaded, just 5 verses. On the 5th verse, that 15-year-old Billy Graham responded to Mordecai Ham's invitation, and he got saved. Oh, wait a minute. Did somebody tell you this? That night, God touched one, but the one he touched millions. Are you persuaded? Almost. Would you like to surrender your life to Jesus Christ? Not now. More convenient. Pastor, I wrote something one day. I said this. I got to thinking, how easy is it to go to hell? And by the way, can I say something? I'll be glad when I'm through. I don't like preaching about hell. My spiritual gift is encouragement. I'd rather be encouraging y'all and everybody smiling and applauding, you know, make you want to go home and pet your poodle. I mean, I want it to. But here's what I said. Here's how easy it is to go to hell. Listen to me, man. In a moment, don't respond to Jesus. Just turn on your heels and leave, okay? And just keep doing that. Next time you come, it's not a big deal. It's not hard. Just turn on your heels and leave. and you do it long enough, you'll leave your, and I wrote a sermon on this, you'll leave your last invitation. And you'll have missed an opportunity, look at me, to live, to really come to life in Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, thank you in Jesus' name for our time together. Do a special work in our lives. Even as you've changed men all weekend, change men, women, and young people today. Draw people to yourself. Heads bowed and eyes closed. I want to be simple. Preacher, you talk about being saved. What do you mean? I can tell you in 30 seconds. Number one, you realize you're a sinner and you ask God in the name of Jesus to forgive you of your sins. And the Bible says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Number two, he comes to live within your life because he knows that you can't live this new life. I can't. He never said I could. He can. He said he always would. I yield to him every day. Christ lives his life through me. Then number three, when this life is over, and please hear me, it will be over. When it's over, I go into eternity. And I know that I have a home in heaven prepared by Jesus for me. I believe with all of my heart my mom's there and I'll see her again. I have a lot of friends there and I know I'll see them again because of Jesus. Are you ready to be saved? Would you like right now for God to step out of heaven, step into your heart, be able to leave here today saying, I know that when I draw my last breath, heaven's my home, and I know that he lives in me. And then to be able to enjoy the new life that he gives you. Pastor put it so wonderfully today. He said, you feel like a 1,000 tons were lifted off your shoulder and off your heart. She surrendered it to Jesus. So right where you sit, you can be saved right there. I'm going to pray. And prayer is our way of talking to God. The focus is not on the prayer. The focus is on Christ and your need of him. Even as he brought me to see the same. So right where you sit, would you just pray in your heart right now and simply say to God, Lord, tell him, Lord, I need you. I know that I cannot save myself. Come into my life. Forgive me of my sins. I'm sorry for my sins. Thank you for dying for me. Save me this morning. Forgive me of my sins. I place my faith in you. And then thank him. Thank him for hearing your prayer, for coming into your life and forgiving you. And then ask him, Lord, help me not to be ashamed. Jesus said he's not ashamed to be called our brothers. You said that if we would admit before men we know you, you will admit before God, the Heavenly Father, that you know us. Help me to never be ashamed of Jesus.